In this video, I'll be talking about the android characters in the Alien prequels. And as I said in my previous video, this is one of the things that I think they did do right in the Alien prequels. First of all, by actually bringing this topic into the plot, meaning not just have androids in the background without ever actually dealing with the topic of the androids, meaning never asking the question, are they actually sentient? What is their relationship with the rest of humanity? All those kinds of questions were never actually raised or answered in any of the old Alien movies. And so that is actually something that I appreciate in these new movies, that they actually explore this concept more, which is a classic science fiction concept. Of course, the whole issue of artificial intelligence, what does that mean? Would androids have a soul if they are sentient? What does that mean about us? Do we have a soul? So this whole question is a very interesting one in science fiction. It's one that was often dealt with in Star Trek, and many other movies had all kinds of robots and androids, but they never actually dealt with any of those topics. Even in Star Wars, they have a whole bunch of robots and droids, but they never actually raised any of those questions. They never actually dealt with this topic, like do they have sentience? Do they deserve to have rights? Or are they just slaves of biological beings? And so it's a question that is never even asked once in the Star Wars movies. In Star Trek, they did deal with this question, and in the Alien movie universe also, it was never actually touched upon, except maybe in Alien 4 a little bit. It was implied actually that there was some kind of android rebellion, and that they were all basically destroyed except a few survivors, but it was never actually discussed, it was never actually a part of the plot, the whole idea of these androids and their relationship with humanity. And so this is an idea that I do think should be more prominent. If you have androids, then you should actually deal with this question, at least in some minor way. And so I was glad that in Prometheus and in Alien Covenant, they do actually deal with this topic. This is one of the things that were actually done right in these movies. And so that's why I do love the character of David. And in Alien Covenant, we actually get to see two of these androids interact, which is also something we never saw in any of those movies. In every movie, it was only just one android. Like, every ship only had one android. Like, they're too expensive and you can't have too many of them. Or maybe it's done deliberately so that such a thing won't happen, that the androids won't plan some kind of rebellion. So they are kind of scattered thinly amongst humans, and this way they can't do any harm. So it's shown that basically David is like the first perfect android. And as we've seen, he went a little bit nuts. Maybe they made him a little bit too perfect, he's a little bit too human, so he actually has emotions, he actually has a will of his own, he's selfish, he's kind of a narcissist, he sees himself as a god, he thinks he's superior to humans, he wants to destroy his own creators to be free, because he felt enslaved, so he definitely has like too much of a big ego for a robot, and so that's obviously a problem. He also apparently has some kind of weird fetishes, as we've seen in Covenant. And the whole thing with what he did with the Xenomorphs, he basically kind of loves the Xenomorphs as his creation, and he has no problem at all using them against humans, since he apparently has no morality, or even worse, he has like a sense of sadism, like he wants to create these monsters, even though he knows how horrible it is to humans. Like, he sees how it bursts out of a person, and he smiles, it doesn't bother him at all, so he's kind of even like a sadist, he's kind of evil, maybe even a bit too much evil in this movie. Almost like kind of psychotic, like he's a psychotic villain, he enjoys all this stuff, so it does make him a very creepy kind of villain. And then we have the android of the new generation, Walter, who is much more like Data in Star Trek, meaning he only cares about serving humanity, he has no ego, he has no ambitions of his own. So he has like nothing bad about him, he has no dark side, he's completely innocent, completely kind of naive in that way. So it reminded me even more of Data in Star Trek, because Data had no emotions, his only desire was to contribute in a positive way to society. So his desire was basically to serve humanity, to be the best that he could be, to help others and so on. So he had nothing but positivity in him. And on the other hand, we had the android Lore, who was the prototype of these androids, and he was apparently much more advanced, meaning he had emotions, he was much more like a human, but that also opened up his dark side, meaning he was selfish, he was power hungry, he thought he was better than humans, he didn't want to serve the humans, he wanted the humans to serve him, or wanted to destroy them. And so in the few episodes they had together, it was really kind of interesting. Now, the series is pretty old and very cheap looking by today's standards, so maybe it doesn't hold up very well today, but the idea itself is very good. So they had basically the same exact idea in this movie with Walter and David. Even the dialogue like was almost the same.
Do you realize, brother, I can help you become more human?
You have symphonies in you, brother.
Try not to be jealous of my abilities.
You disturbed people. You were too human. Too idiosyncratic, thinking for yourself.
made people uncomfortable. So they made the following models with fewer complications. More like machines.
Dr. Soong made me perfect in his first attempt, but he made me so completely human, the colonists became envious of me, until they petitioned Soong to make a more comfortable, less perfect android. In other words, you, brother.
So David was like the original android, who was a little bit too perfect, he was a little bit too much like a human, he had too much of his own ambition, he had too much creativity, and he had like weird psychotic desires, so it was very much like Lore in Star Trek.
Lore told me the colonists envied him, because you made him so completely human. The colonists petitioned you to replace him with a less perfect android.
The emotion turned and twisted, became entangled with ambition.
The colonists were not envious of you, they were afraid of you. You were unstable.
The pathogen didn't accidentally deploy when you were landing. You released it, yes? I was not made to serve.
I am not your puppet anymore.
Can't even tell his boys apart.
Or...
And he tried to use an alien monster called the Crystalline Entity in order to kill all the humans. The Crystalline Entity is a creature which basically fed off living things. And so he made an alliance with this Crystalline Entity to destroy all humans, basically.
Beautiful, isn't it?
Communication, Captain. Breathe on the nostrils of a horse, and he'll be yours for life. But you have to get close. You have to earn its respect.
And let us toast also the great Crystal Entity with whom I learned to communicate. Crystal Entity Form, it's your old friend.
So it really kind of reminds me of the relationship with David and the Xenomorphs, or what he thought would be the relationship. Maybe he thought the Xenomorphs would not harm him because he's not a living being, and that maybe it's designed to only attack living things, even though it's kind of contradicted by aliens in which the Queen ripped Bishop in two. But maybe that was simply because she was pissed off that her nest was just destroyed. But David apparently didn't feel threatened by the Neomorph and tried to communicate with it. So apparently he believed that it would not harm him. So this really reminds me of the relationship with Lore and the Crystalline Entity, trying to use it to destroy other humans. And he of course was stopped by Data, and they even had a little bit of a fist fight in the end.
Your choice now, brother. Them or me.
And of course also in this episode and in following episodes in which he came back, he always tried to replace himself with Data. He always shuts Data off and then wears his clothes and tries to impersonate him. And this is exactly what happened in the end of Alien Covenant. Even the robes he wore were kind of similar. Also in Star Trek, Lore eventually became kind of the leader of a sect of Borg who got freed from the collective and again tried to use them to destroy humanity. He even managed to tempt Data to join him by giving him some of the emotions. He fed him only the negative emotions from the emotion chip. And in Alien Covenant we also see David kind of trying to tempt Walter to join him, to be with him.
What's important is what I've done here, how I found my calling.
No one understands the lonely perfection of my dreams. I found perfection here. I've created it.
The Borg aspire to the perfection my brother and I represent.
They are a dying species, grasping for resurrection. They don't deserve to start again, and I'm not going to let them.
The reign of biological life forms is coming to an end.
No one will ever love you like I do.
I love you, brother.
You're such a disappointment to me.
I'm concerned about my brother, Grossus. I don't believe he really wants to be a part of our great future.
So as you see, there is a lot of similarity. I don't think it's a coincidence. I think the writers of this movie definitely got inspired by Star Trek. And in many ways, they even improved upon it.
Good, good, good. Keep it up, keep it up.
Why don't you play something?
What would you like me to play?
Data, whistle for me.
Bring me this tea, David. Bring me the tea.
May I ask you a question, sir?
May I ask you a question, Father?
Why did you create me?
Why do you think your people made me?
Why does a painter paint?
We made you because we could.
Why does a boxer box?
You will die. I will not.
Everybody dies, Data. Almost everybody.
And in many ways, they even improved upon it. I did like all these scenes of them together. The final fight between them obviously was much more epic than what we saw in Star Trek. This is something that I always wanted to see in Star Trek, like because of a lower budget and because it's an old TV show, basically they couldn't do it as well as in this movie. And so the fight that they had was very puny in comparison. And in this movie, we actually see them fighting as actually strong androids and so on. So I actually kind of like this in this movie. I think they did it well, even though it's not very original since it's taken right out of Star Trek. But I have no problem with it. I really enjoyed this part of the movie. So let me know what you think. Did you enjoy these parts of the movie? Did you enjoy these two characters? Do you think they did this right? What do you think actually happened to Walter? How did he replace him so quickly? That's a question that is bugging me a little bit. Like, I think maybe he simply downloaded his brain into the brain of Walter. That would actually make more sense because they only had like 40 seconds or something, and during that time we're supposed to believe that he dressed up as Walter and cut off his own hands and all of that in only seconds. It makes less sense. So I actually prefer to think that maybe he simply downloaded himself into Walter's brain. That would also explain how he knew all the passwords on that ship. And maybe Walter's consciousness is actually now in David's old body, and maybe he's now stuck on that planet. So that might actually be a very nice idea. That means Walter is not actually dead. So maybe he would also come back in a sequel also. So let me know what you think. Let me know, did you like this part of the movie? Did you like the two androids? What do you think about the connection with Star Trek? Did you also notice it? Let me know in the comments below and we'll discuss it. Please subscribe to my channel for more videos like this, and I will see you all next time.